Is it on?
Okay. So welcome back from lunch, and after not only I'm able to see my slides, but you are able to see my slides too, I will start with the next presentation, which is about use cases and pitfalls in MPLS and VPLS networks. First, a little bit about me. My name is Sebastian Innerker from FMS Internet Service GmbH in Germany. We also have a distribution table here in the exhibition hall. So if you have any questions about me or my presentation, you are able to find me in the exhibition hall at our distributor table. I'm a Microtik trainer since almost 11 years, and I'm also able to offer all the certifications trainings offered by Microtik at the moment. We have our own training center in close to Freiburg in southwest of Germany, but well, I'm doing also on-site trainings and workshops all over Germany and also some European countries and also some exotic countries like Uganda or Greenland. Hello? Yeah. So let's start with an overview or a big picture of my presentation. And my presentation was announced as, well, implementing and running an MPLS and VPLS network is easy as long as it's running well. Topics of my presentation will be, well, some typical use cases of our customers, mostly ISP customers in this presentation. And I'm going to talk about some typical and some maybe surprising pitfalls in your MPLS and VPLS network. And I'm going to use some real-world examples, so I'm not telling any nightmare stories. That's most or all examples are based on real issues I've seen in customer networks. Not main topic of my presentation will be, well, a step-by-step guide to implement MPLS or VPLS or OSPF in your network. I will be mostly focused on pitfalls you could run into, and also not main topic of my presentation will be reasons for running MPLS or VPLS in your network, because, well, if you want to run VPLS or MPLS in your network, you should know why you want to run MPLS or VPLS in your network. Please don't implement MPLS in your network just because it's possible with Microtik routers. But, well, okay, I will give you a quite short and incomplete reason for MPLS and VPLS. Benefits, or some benefits of MPLS are, well, MPLS is less complex than the routing process. So, yeah, transporting a packet from A to B will be less complex, which will increase throughput and so on. And maybe some future setups of your network will require MPLS, for example, so-called layer 3 VPNs or so-called traffic engineering. Benefits of VPLS compared or versus Ethernet over IP is that you don't have any packet fragmentation in VPLS tunnels, VPLS layer 2 tunnels, if done right, and you'll have a big overhead on Ethernet over IP layer 2 tunnels. And if you have a big overhead in your packets or in your Ethernet over IP tunnel, you will lose throughput, and it will cause fragmentation in your of your packets. According to the pitfalls I will show you, of course, list of pitfalls will be incomplete. I'm not going to talk about all pitfalls you could run into, because I don't know all pitfalls you could run into. And the pitfalls I'm talking about will not be limited to MPLS or VPLS, because, well, VPLS is based on some dependencies. For example, if you want to run VPLS layer 2 tunnels instead of Ethernet over IP layer 2 tunnels, well, first requirement will be MPLS. So if you want to use VPLS, your complete network have to be MPLS or have to run MPLS. MPLS is based on routing. I'm going to use OSPF as an example in our test setup here. And of course, your network will be based on the physical infrastructure you have to take care of. Now I have to give you a big warning or heads up or caution note. This presentation will include errors, mistakes, and wrong configuration attempts for me to be able to show you some resulting errors of your misconfiguration or wrong design decisions. Of course, examples are simplified, so you don't have to dig your head into a very, very complex network setup. So examples are simplified. And again, this presentation will include some errors, mistakes, and yeah, not so good design decisions. Keep that in mind. It's just to show you the resulting errors. So let's start with your small network. You just have a running OSPF network. You have a main site where your PPUE access concentrator is located. You have an internet uplink router. And on your main site, you'll have one PPUE server and then router number one. That router number one will be or is connected to router two. Router two is connected to router three. And then you have two paths from router number three to router number six. On and connected to router number six, there's a remote router, router number seven, which is on the far end of your network. And as you can see here, you have two paths or two connections between router number three and router number six. So one of our paths will be a backup path, and the other one will be the production, the productive link. In this presentation, the link through router number four, that's the upper one here, will be our backup link, and the production link is going through router number five. And on top of your existing OSPF network, you have Ethernet over IP layer 2 tunnels running to be able to connect your PPUE clients connected to router number 3, router number 6, and router number 7 to your PPUE server. So you already have a routed network with OSPF running on top, layer 2 tunnels, and you want to replace your layer 2 tunnels with VPLS layer 2 tunnels. So the good thing about implementing MPLS is that you can integrate MPLS into your running OSPF network without service interruption. So you can start with your working OSPF network and yeah, put MPLS an MPLS network on top of your existing network. So there's no service interruption while you convert your network from routing to MPLS. And if you are going to run MPLS on top of OSPF, you have to enable LDP, a so-called label distribution protocol. You have to set an, or you should set a label switching router ID, set a transport address, and then create so-called LDP interfaces on your device. So the first issue you could run into, well, you don't have to set an LSR ID or label switching route ID or a transport address. But if you don't set an LSR ID or a transport address, the router will take just one IP address which is set up or configured on your device, on your router. And in this example, you would have two routers, router number two and router number three. Both are connected to an uplink router, and on the local side, you will have the same IP subnet, which is 10.0.0.0/24, and you're doing network address translation in direction to your uplink router. So on the uplink router side, of course, you have dedicated unique IP addresses, but on the local side, where your local network is connected to, you could have the same IP address on more than one router. That's not an issue at all, because you're doing network address translation in your uplink direction, but well, you have you have the same IP address on your local side, and the label switching router ID could happen that it's the same on more than one device. And as you can imagine, having an ID which is not unique is not the best idea. So we are going to create an unique IP address for LDP, for our label distribution protocol, and we're going to use an IP address 10.255.255.routernumber/32, and we're going to place that IP address on one of our physical interfaces of our router. And after creation of our unique IP address, which is unique for our device, for our router, we can use the same IP address as an ID for OSPF as well, if you're not already doing that, because it's the same issue with duplicate IDs as on MPLS or LDP. If you have one duplicate router ID in your OSPF networks, you will have some strange or complicated issues in your network. But when you, or if you don't have a router ID set in your OSPF network and you start setting one address, please take into account or take care of that that's a service affecting action. So if you set the router ID, your OSPF will do a restart and, well, you will lose your routing table for a moment. So you have to do that during a maintenance window or just before your router is going into production. Then you have to create so-called LDP interfaces. And by doing, or if you create your LDP interfaces, please, again, please don't forget your backup path. And if you're not sure, you could just compare your OSPF interfaces and your LDP interfaces, for example. Because if you're running OSPF on one interface, well, you might want to run MPLS on that interface too, so just use the same LDP interfaces than OSPF interfaces. After creating your, or after you created your MPLS network, or tried to create your MPLS network, you can create VPLS tunnels for your layer 2 connectivity. And that's not very complicated. It's nearly the same as doing an Ethernet over IP tunnel. All you have to do is to set a, you have to set a remote peer address. That's the IP address of the remote peer. And you have to set a unique VPLS ID, which is the same on both ends, quite easy. Same as on, or nearly the same as on Ethernet over IP, if you are familiar with Ethernet over IP. After creating your VPLS interfaces, you can check your VPLS tunnel, but you can see here, okay, the VPLS interface, the VPLS tunnel is not running. Maybe you can read it here, but maybe not. But it's just missing a running sign, so the VPLS tunnel is not functional. And if you check your MPLS informations on your device, you'll see the MPLS local bindings are empty, the MPLS remote bindings are empty, the MPLS forwarding table is empty. So something is completely wrong in your MPLS network. But luckily, the solution is quite easy, or as soon as you found it, there are just missing routes to your dedicated router IP addresses. So if you don't have a route to 10.255.255.routernumber, and you're using these IP addresses in your VPLS tunnels, well, okay, your tunnel is not able to come up. And which results in, as soon as you have a working routing table, for example by OSPF, to your dedicated router IP addresses, 10.255.255.router number, your VPLS tunnel is coming up. Okay, first thing first. So lesson learned could be, well, MPLS is based on routing. So if you have a broken or an incomplete routing, well, your MPLS network will be broken or incomplete. And, well, if you have a broken MPLS network, your VPLS tunnels will be broken or not running or not functional. So if you debug your network, please consider dependencies. Because, as I told you, VPLS is based on MPLS, MPLS is based on routing, and so on. So, and after we fixed our MPLS network, we can take a look at the working trace route from router number 7 from the far end of our network to router number 1 on the main side. And as you can see here, you see a trace route from 7 to 1, going through router number 5, which is our main connection. And maybe you can read it on the slides here. You'll see some MPLS labels given on the trace route, and that's fine. Maybe you see that there's no label on the last hop, but, well, that's fine. So, let's break things. First thing would be, go to the next slide, and well, we could do some maintenance on our backup link. Well, backup link, so why care about our backup link? So we're doing maintenance on our backup link on router number 4. OSPF is going through router number 5, as expected, as always, because that's our main link. But customers at router number 3 will complain that they don't have any internet connectivity. But customers on router number 6 and router number 7 are fine. But, well, customers at router number 3 are offline. The reason is, or maybe you find out, okay, the VPLS tunnel from router number 1 to router number 3 is not running. Yeah, well, what could be a reason for that? It's, again, after you found it, quite easy. Because you did some, or because you do some maintenance on router number 4, you have no link on the physical interface going from router number 3 to router number 4. So, link between 3 and 4 is missing, and, well, we made a mistake because we placed the unique router IP address on the physical interface facing router number 4, which is down for maintenance. So we don't have any link on the physical interface Ethernet 4, and because we placed the IP address on the physical interface Ethernet number 4, there's no routing entry for IP address 10.255.255.3, and because you don't have any routing information to router number 3, you're missing MPLS forwarding entries for router number 3. And that's exactly the reason for having a loopback interface or a loopback bridge. And a loopback bridge is just a bridge, an empty bridge interface, which is, yeah, always up and running. So it doesn't matter which interface state your physical interface will have, your loopback bridge will be up and running all the time. And let's place the IP address, our dedicated router IP address, on that loopback interface, which is always up and running. Next thing, well, let's have a failure at our main link. Expected behavior would be, well, routing should be go through router number 4. Expected behavior is customers at water number 3, 6 and 7 are online. But observed behavior will be, well, routing is going through water number 4, but customers at water number 6 and 7 are offline. But, well, let's first check again with a ping. If you do a ping from router number 1 to router number 7, you'll see on the screenshot on the right, the ping is absolutely fine. So ping is okay. But if you take a look at the traceroute here, you will see that traceroute is going to your destination. There's no MPLS label on the last hop, which is fine, but there is also an MPLS label missing in between of your path from 1 to 7, and that's an issue. Well, checking router number 3, you'll see, okay, you have 3 LDP interfaces, which are Ethernet 2, Ethernet 3, and Ethernet 4. But if you compare that list of interfaces with your OSPF interfaces, you'll see OSPF interfaces will be or are Ethernet 3, 4, and 5. So Ethernet 2 is just a mistake. You have to change that IP, that interface from Ethernet 2 to Ethernet 5 to have an working MPLS or LDP session on that interface. Quite an easy one, but if you remember, if you have a larger network, it will be more complicated. And in most cases, this issue will arise on a backup link, which is not in production until your main link is failing. And then you will have an, well, working backup link, but, well, your network is down too. So let's examine our network a little bit more. For example, we can do a bandwidth test from a PPUE client connected to router number 4 and router number 7. Sorry, and the PPUE client is going through your VPLS layer 2 tunnel to your PPUE server. And because we have an MTU of 1492. Because of our PPPUE dial-in connection, we are going to test with UDP packets with a packet size of 1492, which is the MTU of our dial-in connection. So we don't have to, or we don't want to have fragmentation because of the PPPUE connection. But as you can see here, on router number 1, which is connected to your PPUE server and your backbone, that you have, well, about 850 packets per second facing your PPUE server, but the interface facing your backbone will have twice as much packets. So, well, what's wrong here? Maybe packet fragmentation? But, well, I just told you one benefit of VPLS over Ethernet over IP is no packet fragmentation, if done right. And, well, we have to take care of no automatic packet fragmentation in our VPLS tunnel by taking a look at, well, packet sizes. Please don't run away. It will not as bad as you expect. So, if you take a look at just an IP packet or a PPUE packet, you'll see, or you might have a full frame or layer 3 size of 1500. That's your normal layer 3 packet size, maybe. And if you, and to be complete, there will be also an Ethernet header of 14 bytes attached to your packet that has to be transported by your layer 2 tunnel to have a real layer 2 connectivity between both ends of your tunnel. What's going to happen if you just encapsulate your packet, your original frame, into a VPLS tunnel? You'll have, well, your original frame extended by an MPLS tag, an VPLS tag, and a so-called control word. And with the resulting so-called layer 2 or MPLS MTU will be, well, the sum of all labels and your original frame. So the resulting MPLS MTU will be, well, 1526. So your original frame, which is 1514 plus the VPLS tunnel labels. And the VPLS packet is fragmented automatically because, well, again, the resulting MPLS MTU is 1526, but the default value for the interface MPLS MTU is 158. So there's a configured default MPLS MTU of 158, and 1526 is bigger than 158, so MPLS, no, that's wrong, VPLS will do packet fragmentation automatically. You don't have to take care about that. It will be done automatically, but, well, it will be done. So if, and please, only if your hardware is capable of transporting or forwarding bigger frames, you could increase the interface MTU in your network. But, well, you have to check that your hardware is able to transmit this kind of packets. So, for example, you can take a look at the maximum transmit units on router boards. You'll find layer 2 MTUs for different router boards. And please don't forget any switches or media converters in your network. So maybe your MikroTik network is absolutely fine, but you have one third-party vendor, a media converter, for example, which is not able to transmit packets of that size, and you will have strange or complicated or not to foresee issues in your network. So after you set your MPLS MTU to 1526, you'll see, okay, packet fragmentation is done. You have corresponding packet counters on all involved interfaces. So next question could be, why 15.8? Well, 15.8 is just enough for MPLS for packet forwarding as a replacement for routing, for example, and it's also enough for so-called targeted LDP, which is going to use two MPLS labels, but, well, 4 plus 4 will be 8, but which is exactly the same size as 15.8. So why not use a default value of 1526? Well, easy answer, 1526 might be too large for your hardware, for your MikroTik hardware, or for your third-party vendor hardware. Next, we are going to do some network improvements. For example, in our current network, we don't have any redundancy, and we want to change that. A few words about redundancy. Well, the type or the coverage depends on your, well, your setup, your needs, and your customers or your network. So maybe you don't have the need for full redundant network, because it would be quite okay if you have a failure for maybe half an hour or whatever. And I have absolutely no claim for completeness in telling you about redundancy. I'm just giving you some examples that have to be extended by you or adapted by you to your own network. And please remember, redundancy can become quite complex, and complexity can again result in some issues in your network. When I'm going to talk about redundancy, I'm not going to talk about redundancy on your main site. So I'm not talking about redundant PPE servers and so on, because that was topic of the presentation of my colleague Patrick Sharp today in the morning. So I'm going to talk about redundancy in the backbone network. So first thing, or first approach, or first example will be, we are going to have an additional link and IP subnet between router number one and router number two. So the one that is located on our main site and the router that is connected on the other one. The second link will be a backup link, just the same as you did it on router number three to router number six. So one of that links will be our backup link. And when you create a backup connection between one and two, please, again, don't forget to add the corresponding LDP interface. So that's the redundancy in our network. So we have two connections from one to two. Next thing, we are going to take care of redundancy for router number one, the central router in our network. So our approach will be, we are cloning the configuration of router number one, and the result will be router number one main and router number one backup. And we are going to use dedicated IP addresses 10.255.255.11 and 12 on main and backup. Our main link is connected to router one main, and our backup link will be connected to our backup router. And VPLS is going to the IP address 10.255.255.1, same as before. So as you can see here, we formally we got two connections from one router to our neighboring router. Now we have two routers on our main side, and each of it is connected by a network connection to router number two. Well, the big question, or miracle, will be, who's main and who's backup? Or in other words, who is 10.255.255.1, where our VPLS tunnels are going through? We are not going to use VRRP between main and backup on the interface facing router number two, because on the interface facing router number two, we don't have any layer two connectivity, because there's a layer three network in between. So we are not able to use VRRP between backup and main on the uplink side, or on the side directed in our backbone network. Well, we could create a layer two network between router one main and router one backup, but that would require to have a switch, for example, on router number two, and both or all three devices will be in the same layer three network. But then the backup path decision will be based on RSTP, and maybe you don't want to have OSPF routing decisions. And also, what would happen if you do VRP on the interface facing your router number two? Well, if a link between main and your local site is down, VRP will be fine, because we are doing VRP on the opposite side, on the router to facing router number two. So a failing link into our main site will not be detected. But, well, our main router and our backup router are connected to our main site on a switch, so we are able to do VRP on the local main site side. So, and let's just implement VRP on our main site, so on router number one main. We set the IP address of our VPLS tunnels on the VRF interface. We are going to use a label switching route ID as a transport address of 10.255.255.1 on both devices, and we are going to use a dedicated IP address for OSPF loopback. So if your router number one main is failing, expected behavior would be IP address is switching from main to backup. the VPLS tunnel is going from main to backup, and PVE clients are reconnecting. Observed behavior is everything's fine. But what would happen if the link between router number one main and router two is failing? Expected behavior would be, well, the IP address is still on the main router because VRP is fine. Main is our VRP master, and we don't have any route to our VPLS tunnel endpoint 255.1 because there's no OSPF running anymore on the uplink router. And clients are offline. Well, let's place a crosslink between main and backup router and do OSPF between them and create LDP on that crosslink, and expected behavior would be, well, IP address is switching. The IP address of our VPLS tunnel is still on main, but there's a route to our VPLS tunnel endpoint through router R1 backup, and expected behavior would be clients and VPLS is okay. Observed behavior, clients are offline. So if you test from router number two, you'll see ping is working. The route is going through router number one backup. But if you take a look at the trace route from router number seven, you might see ping is also okay, but there's an MPLS label missing on the penultimate hop, which is not okay. Missing label on the last hop is okay, but not on both, or on the last two ones. So routing between backup and main is okay, but MPLS or LDP is broken between main and backup, because as you can see here, we don't have any forwarding table on MPLS. So routing is not enough for VPLS. So a simple reason is, well, we use the IP address 255.1 on as a label switching route ID and transport address and on backup and on main. The IP address of our VPLS tunnels is only active on our main router, which is the VRP master. And you might recognize, well, having duplicate IP addresses is not a good idea, so we have to fix that. One possible solution would be to switch the label switching route ID as a transport address according to the VRP state. So if you are VRP master, then LSR ID and transport address will be 255.1. And if you are in backup state, it will get a unique IP address for LSR and transport address. So on the slides, you will see some script to take care of that. And maybe as the last part, will be some traffic improvements we are going to use in our network, or some use case of VPLS or MPLS, or in this case, MPLS in our network. Well, at the moment, all of 100% of our traffic from router number 6 and 7 is going through router number 5. So our backup link is not used at all. But we want to use our backup link to share the load between 4 and 5. But OSPF, MPLS, and VPLS is going through router number number 5, so router number 4 is not used at all. And in this case, we could use so-called traffic engineering or traffic engineering tunnels. And for that, first of that, we have to enable traffic engineering support on all involved interfaces. Again, compare MPLS interfaces and OSPF interfaces. Then we're going to use so-called traffic engineering tunnels. And the trick is that we are able to set or define some primary and then secondary paths, and we can make sure that our tunnel is using the primary path until it fails. If it fails, it will go through our secondary path, but if our primary path is okay, it will use a primary path. And by setting a primary tunnel path, we can say, okay, I don't care how to get to your destination, but you have to include router number 4 into your path between source and destination. So that's the trick to force a route through router number 4, and then you can create your traffic engineering tunnel. So you'll set the from address, the to address, so both ends of the tunnel on both sides, and you set primary path will be through router number 4. Secondary path is, I don't care how to get to your target, but go there. And the result will be, well, the load is shared between router number 4 and router number 5, so you'll have maybe 10 megabits per second coming from router number 6 and router number 7, and the traffic is going, or one tunnel is going through router number 4, so you will have 10 megabits per second on router number 4 and 10 megabits per second on router number 5, so your backup link is not lost at all, but you are using your backup connection. The good thing is, if your backup link is failing, well, the tunnel will switch to the secondary path, which is going through router number 5, and everything is fine. And I think I have to come to an end. And just to show you what's on the slides, or which can be downloaded in the wiki maybe next week, I think I'm not going to talk about OSPF issues which could occur. Maybe you can take a look at the slides here. So that's an example that it might seem that your OSPF network is running well, but you can have some strange behavior in the situation if you are using firewalling, for example, or bridge horizon values, or maybe on wireless if you're using default forwarding, or if you disable default forwarding on your wireless link. So maybe you can take a look at these examples on your own. I hope you will be able to understand it. But the issue here is that if you have a so-called broadcast domain in your network, in your OSPF network, the broadcast domain will choose a so-called designated router, which have to be updated by routing informations. And if your router is not able to update your so-called designated router, well, the routing update will not arrive in your OSPF network. So finally, I made it, and I have to say thank you. And well, here's a little picture of a test setup.